picked the wrong week. Quit sniffing glue.
And welcome back. It is the last full week in April of 2017, and what I am confident will be the second, well, I know it's the second, but I'm confident it'll be the final week of the Kane build. And where we left, when we last left our hero, he had gotten a nice coat of clear satin, and I was ready to do the weathering on the suit, but then I realized, ooh, this is the best time to put the decals down, because there are patches and name badges and things like that on the suit that need to be weathered over top of them. You wouldn't go out and, you know, put a jumpsuit on, go out, get grungy, and then slap your patches on. So I gotta stop, put the decals on, seal those in, and then I can do the weathering. And there are two different ways I am going to be putting the decals on because of the two different finishes of the kit. So enough of this yammering, let's get down to it.
Okay, here are the two examples that I've got to offer you today, the two different types, because I've got decals that will be going on the suit, and I've got decals that will be going on the backpack. Now, the backpack does not have the clear poly or the clear satin finish on it, so what I'm going to be doing in that case is taking a Q-tip with some Future on it, which is a floor wax. This is a clear wax finish that I will be sealing the decals in between coats of that, so I don't have to spray the whole magilla, just the area where the decal is going. And all I'm going to be doing really is just brushing on a wee bit of the Future and letting that dry, and then putting a decal over top of it. What that does, what Future does, and what putting a clear finish over your surface before you decal does for you is it makes a very smooth surface. And a very smooth surface is what you want to put under your decals, because then you don't have the problem of trapped air. And trapped air is what causes the silvering that you see around decals, or what causes them to age and yellow, and you get that haze or that line around your decal. That that's something you don't want. And what that is air being trapped between the decal and the irregular surface of the paint. So if you can minimize that, then your decal will lay flat, and you blot out the air bubbles underneath, and everybody's just generally happier with how things turn out. So a smooth surface under your decal is the most important thing you can do to ensure that your decals are going to lay down flat, and the carrier film is going to disappear after you've done that. So I'm going to start applying the decals. No great mystery to that, except you wet down the area with water, or in Future in these cases, and slide the decal in place, blot the excess water from underneath, and then you blot them dry. And if your decal is going over an irregular surface, you may want to use something like this, which is called Solvacet, and it will allow the decal to actually melt. So it's going to make your decal look ugly for a while, but don't touch it while it does that. And then when it settles back out, it'll nestle itself down to all the little nooks and crannies and conform to your kit. So I'm just going to go ahead and slap some decals down and then show you the results. Here's one big good example of a decal that I can show you putting down. That's his big old butt patch that goes here. It's delineated here in the molding, and actually has some relief of the design of the patch, so we should have a good chance of the design really taking over the contours of where it's supposed to be. I'm just dangling that in water for a few seconds. Nothing really, I'm not letting it soak, but I'll let it sit out here. And I've taken a Q-tip, and I've just wet down the area to make it extra receptive. And I'll let this decal soak in this water for a second or two. Now I have put the coats of the Future on the backpack, and I'm letting that dry for a few minutes before I go into that. So I'm looking for other decals that I can do while I'm waiting for that to happen. And doing this one-handed, oh, that came off really nice. Okay, so it slides off of the paper, and doing this one-handed is tricky. But I'm trying to capture the action live and as it happens. So there you go. It's down. Now, take a X-Acto if you're careful. Most people prefer to use a Q-tip to do this, but sometimes I find the Q-tip just doesn't grab it like it should. And position that down. Get it where it's supposed to be getting. And just blot it in place with a Q-tip. Switch between dry and wet. And blot that puppy in place. Okay, now here's something that happens when you're putting decals down that normally is, you know, a tragedy. But in this case, not so much. When removing the Kane name from the backing piece, when sliding that off, it ripped. Decals rip sometimes. Depending on the, you know, the quality of the decal and the age of the decal, they'll either come off nice and smooth or they'll rip and you have to piece them back together. Now, it's not a great tragedy in this case because if you look at the reference from the box, and I'm going to, excuse me while I do this zooming here, you can see that that decal is barely legible and it's going to require me to do some aging over top of it anyway. Now, this is where, you know, instead of giving you an aged decal, they give you this bright, fresh decal. And it's got a rip in it, so, you know, no big deal. What I'm going to do is muddy over top of that and probably drag a toothpick through it anyway to scratch more of it off. So, in this case, it's not worth trying to go back in and fix it just because we're going to age it anyway. The Phoenix symbol or the Weyland-Yutani symbol here is much too clean, and I'm going to have to dirty that up some. And for some odd reason, they give you this decal that is the same color as the bronze, so you really don't see it when you're done anyway. But if this were a clean, you know, fancy starship, and that was some, you know, pinstripe pennant, then yeah, I'd get all panicky and worried about trying to fix that decal. But here, it's a delicious side effect of the grunge nature of the subject that you don't really have to worry about that. It's a happy accident, as Bob Ross would say. No mistakes, just happy accidents. Here's the butt patch settling in, and most of the decals on this kit end up going on the backpack here, so I've more or less covered the whole thing with future, and I'm letting that dry. But there are a couple more that I need to put on the gloves. These guys here need to go on the gloves and such like that. So let me finish that up. Okay, here's a tale of two decals. One went on perfectly. Guess which one. And one fell apart as I was taking it off and moving it around. So again, I try to camouflage that damage as best I can. But on the suit, both decals survive. So if they are a little bit smaller in real life than the decal on the kit part is. So I'm going to let those dry, and then I'm just going to have to put some battle damage around that to disguise the fact that it's screwed up. And also the decal inside the gauges there is a little bit large. You see how it is taking up more space than it should. So I'm going to be damaging that one as well. Like I say, this particular subject, you can hide some of this damage in better than other kits. The decals are down, and that's the best I can say about that. Some of them went down easily, some of them did not. Although this, I should not have expected any better. This is, after all, the same company that spectacularly screwed up the decals for the Reliant kit. So I should have kind of steeled myself against the expectations of how the decals turned out. When they worked very well. Those ones went on the gloves like a champ. When they did not work, they did not work spectacularly. And like I say, it's a lucky thing on this particular kit that I can hide the damage. And it also shows you a new technique of how to hide damage on a decal. So I'm going to let these guys dry for a few hours before I try to coat over top of them. And I will go off and enjoy myself for a couple of hours and then come back and hit them with a clear coat and start doing some final weathering. Well, it's a few hours later and all of the decals have had a good opportunity to set up, and most of them are looking pretty darn good. As good as they're going to, for the ones that laid down properly, like that one. That's still the butt end one, is still the shining success of, amongst all of them, which is good because, you know, it's fairly visible. These ones in the backpack that are going to be right up in your face, 50-50. I did find, because googly eyes are the set, are like duct tape, they'll fix anything, that this lens cover over this gauge is exactly the same size as that googly eye. So I'm going to cut the back of it off and glue it in place to give it a little bit of extra added detail. And it has been just ugly raining constantly all day, so it's way too wet out and way too humid out to spray these with a coat of sealer. So this may end up being what I can do for the day, and I may have to concentrate on finding some other little aspect to work on that I can accomplish while it's raining outside. Okay, that googly eye is going to work as a lens cover, but I just realized that I need to, since I sealed these decals in, I do need to spray over top of it with a flat to seal everything in, and that's just going to end up fogging up this googly eye cover. So it's like a contact lens right now. I need to leave that off until after that spray has gone on so I don't fog that up. So we're stuck on that again. I can patch some of these, maybe patch up some of these decals that got ripped up and broken. That black one settled into the crevices kind of nice, but you can see some spots where it ripped, and I could take some black paint and kind of touch those up. Not my best work, nothing I'm really proud of there. I don't know if you can appreciate this for what it is, but this is the first time the sun has come out in over 3 days. It has been raining non-stop, and you can see that the birds and the squirrels are happy that the sun is out, and I am happy that the sun is out because I can put the top coat of the satin clear over top of the decals and get them ready for weathering this afternoon. Listen to the wondrous sounds of nature. And it's finally wash day here on the Kane figure. What I'm doing basically is putting a wash over the jumpsuit to bring out, or to sink back, I guess you bring out highlights and you sink back shadows and contrasts, and that's what I'm doing. And you can see the difference between this leg and the same colors on the other leg as an example to show you how much wash I'm leaving in. And any good wash depends on three factors of a good wash. It's A, what color of wash you choose to use. B, how thick the wash is, whether it's really runny or whether it has a lot of pigment. And C, how much you wipe off. So, you know, basically those are the three passes of any wash. If it's really thick and full of pigment and you leave it on for a real long while and you don't wipe it off very strongly, then you're going to be left with a lot of dark color. If, on the other hand, you have a very light wash and the pigment is really diluted and you wipe it off really quickly, then you're going to have very more subtle wash. So, and I can't do this with two hands or with one hand, so I'm going to put this down for a second. There, I've got that wiped off. I had it on too thick and I was afraid it was drying too quickly, so I had to drop the camera to wipe it off. Of course, a good thing about an acrylic wash is that if you feel you have put too much on, you can always just take a brush with water on it and wipe it down, you know, splash some water on it and wipe it off before it gets, you know, really set. And that's why you want to have a nice clear coat underneath, because the clear coat or the wash is not going to soak into a clear coat. It's going to ride on top of the clear coat, and it's much easier to wipe off. Where if it's a flat coat or if the paint has a lot of tooth to it, then anything you put over top of it is going to be much more difficult to wipe off. It's going to want to sink right into the finish. And I think I've got the legs to where I'm happy with them. And weathering, probably more than any other aspect of building, is where you can express your own particular style. It's weathering is as much an art form as a craft. Once you are good at it, or once you get a level that you're happy with, you will find it's probably the quickest way to enhance your models and make them look really special and really unique by how much weathering you choose to do. Here's a just as an overall idea. You can see how much grunge is collecting now in the recesses, and it doesn't, now the kit, this is, hasn't been weathered yet, and this has, and I'll show you how the two halves look next to each other, because it's really the best way to take off that fresh from the factory look. Do you see the torso has not been weathered, and the waist and legs have, and it really just adds that stamp of realism to your figure. Now the last bit I'll put on here is a flat coat, and that really will make it look realistic, much more realistic. And then I'll go back in and dry brush some highlights, because weathering doesn't stick to all surfaces evenly, or it shouldn't. Like the belt buckles that are plastic probably wouldn't retain the grime like the cloth would, so you go back in and you wipe those down or repaint them. You could say that the leather shoes or the rubber soles of the feet or of the shoes would collect weathering at a different rate. So you you play with those things, but you experiment and you get to have fun and remember that you're making a model that is individual and yours. So don't be afraid to experiment. Now this chest piece and back, I had to put a clear coat over to put those decals down, and now I'm going to put some weathering over top of those decals to really dirty them down and make them look like they are part of the armor. And I'll get into making the weathering stick to the ribs here, because you want something to stick to your ribs. But let's do this piece next. And really it's as simple as brushing on a very thin wash of a color. And I'm using ComArt Rojas Stone Flesh. I was looking for the soft dirt, which is not that different of a color. But this also, well, like I say, tones down those yellows and gives it a more grounded, realistic color. Okay, because I had been asked to do more actual work on camera, I'm going to go ahead and do this arm. This arm here, this hand, hello, how you doing? This hand, live and in person, with the ComArt. So basically, I'm just getting a little bit on the old brush, and just smearing it around. Try not to do too well. The arms are small. I can probably get away with doing all of them at the same time. And like I say, it's a question of how long you leave it in place before you start to wipe off. Now, I'm not putting any on the shoulder or trying not to get too much on the shoulder, because I'm kind of happy with how it looks. And now I'm just taking a chunk of old t-shirt, sold separately, and just blotting it back off. And you can see, and blotting it off and then wiping it. And it'll collect where you can't, where it does, because I can't get in. And for if I want to get some stuff out of the crevices, I can use a Q-tip and just, you know, go like that and wipe it off. But it's giving me all these little subtle dirt marks on here. Now I'm going to go ahead and put a little bit more and a little bit stronger in the palm of the glove, because you're going to imagine that the palm of the glove probably sees more dirt than any other part of the suit, because you're always grabbing things with your grubby hand. So I am dabbing that more than trying to wipe it off. I'm leaving more on by dabbing it.
and want to make sure that the dirt settles in between the fingers there. Just really leaving more on the surface of the glove than I am, like, say, on the arm and stuff. And it really just goes that quickly. It's not something that you have to spend hours laboring over. And if you feel, I've said it before, and I'll repeat myself, if you feel you've gotten too much on, you can always take a brush that's loaded with water and, you know, go over it again and lift some of that back out. And then redo it, you know, as many times as it takes for you to be happy with the results. And now you see why you go that bright with your yellows, because by the time you put this wash on here, it's going to mute down the yellow and the whites and all of those really bright colors. And it does end up looking a little bit more, like I say, natural, but maybe natural isn't the right, realistic, if that's the term you want to use for a fictional spacesuit model. And then, go ahead and use that term. Looks more real. Now, like I said, you can always come back to it. And if you don't think you've put on enough after the first coat, let that coat dry. And then come back in and put some more. And depending on how much you blot off and how much you leave on there. Like I say, weathering is a very personal thing, and I can't tell you what looks right. I can tell you what looks right for me. I can't tell you what looks right for you. It's like so many other things. I know it when I see it, but it's not necessarily a quantifiable, set of rules that are written down in a book somewhere of how much weathering is too much. You'll know when you put too much weathering on, whether it's too much or not. See, and it just gets done that quickly. I'll go ahead and whip out the other arm while I'm at it. This might be a little bit easier because it's the arm is stretched out, but same thing, same techniques. Go with a little bit more diluted version of the Comart wash here. And then just blot it. Wipe it down. Now I'm going to try something that's got a little bit more of a thicker pigment here. Less of a wash and more of a pigment. Trying to keep away from, well, I'll put a little bit of it on there, but mostly trying to keep away from the catcher's mitt or the big shoulder or elbow pad, because I want that to be fairly light. I think it's got enough wash on it. But I wanted to get more wash into these different colored stripes here, into that weave, the texture of the material there. Just throw some more in there. Wherever you see, you think you might need. Sorry, I'm sounding like Bob Ross. It looks like it needs to be a little bit in here. Just a little bit of happy weathering. And overall, the gloves are a hair darker than the rest of the suit. Because, again, I would imagine the gloves made of a different material. They would absorb weathering differently than the sleeve material, or certainly the metallics or the plastics of the latches or the metal of the armor or the shoulder pieces and whatnot. These are molded after, obviously, they look like hockey gloves. So I know that those are kind of a plastic or, you know, pleathery type of material, whereas the fabric of the arms is much more of a, looks more like a canvas. So I would imagine it would suck up weathering at a different rate. But there, quickly done. I think I'm gonna go back and put a little bit more on that glove, just on the palm of the hand, and then blot it off quickly. It's important to me to know that the weathering is consistent amongst all of the suits. So I want to make sure that the arms have the same amount of weathering as the torso. It's okay if the gloves are used a little bit worse, but I generally want the arms and the torso to match, and I think they do. I like that. So I'm going to go ahead. I think I'm ready to go ahead and glue these arms in. No, I'm going to hold off on that. Don't have to do that today. Now let's see if this backpack needs anything. It's got the weathering from the corrosion of the metal, but let's see if it needs any of the of this comm art weathering. Is that helping me any? Is it giving me anything new? Not particularly. So I think I'm gonna wipe most of that back off and leave it just, well, no, I may have to go back over that with the blue to kind of bring that back up. So we'll let that go. But yeah, and by the time you fit that on there, that's gonna be quite nice. And that's weathering 101. Well, what do you know, it's time to put some parts together. This has been long enough that we haven't really had any good construction lately. So what I'm going to do, I've gone ahead and checked to make sure. If I put these two pieces together like I want to do, am I going to be able to get the wiring through? Well, I tried it just by fishing up a wire through the bottom of the knee, and yes, it comes out just fine. So I know it's safe to go ahead and put these two pieces together. And I'm going to do that and put, gotta stop doing that. Go ahead and put the arms on and then give this guy a good flat coat. And then we'll be ready to run. Well, I got to put a flat coat on him. And then what I'm going to do is do any last minute dry brushing to bring out some colors that I want to do. And then he'll be ready for his attachments. And we can go back to working on the egg, but let's go ahead and put these pieces together. And I think what I want to do is mix up some epoxy for that, because they're awfully heavy, and I just think it's going to be a little bit more stable if I go ahead and put some epoxy together. Well, it is Wednesday and it's time to start putting all these elements together. The body is, I'm going to call, largely done. Put a flat coat over it yesterday and it has aged things down amazingly, and all the pieces are now stuck together. I need to attach the gun, but I'm talking about that little detail stuff. The big ticket item is to get the helmet in place and get the backpack on, get it wired up, and that's kind of what I am addressing today. I'm getting all my wiring doodahs together so that I can start attaching everything to where it needs to go for the good and final time. Okay, it's time to start serious work on the base. And the first thing I need to do, I want to attach this bottom plate to the rest of the base. But the first thing I need to do is to map out where the battery box is going to be. And to do that, since you can't really see through this base very well, is I've taken just a piece of one of these sanding sticks and put some paint on it, tucked it down through that top hole, and that gave me a spot right there. And from that, I know that I've got, you know, that's where I need to center my battery. So put battery there and draw a box around it, and then build a box around it. And that's, once I do that, I can hollow out this area. So then I will be able to change the battery in and out. Okay, folks, we're coming down to what I call the best part of a build, because this is just
raw, naked fabrication. I need to make up a box for this battery, and I'm just taking some scratch building at its finest. It is just strip styrene that I'm going to make up a box. I'm not going to put a top on it because the base itself will act as the top. I just need a box to put the battery in, and then I'll cut nibble a little hole to run the battery wires out, and then we will be darn close to being ready to attach this to this. Now, there's also going to be a question of running the wiring down and getting it all secured before we can attach this base to that. So it's kind of one of those things we got to figure out what order it's going to go in and what is going to be the easiest way to work it, because I want to minimize the stress on that magnet wire. So that is the determining factor. So let me get this box built up and we'll come right back. Okay, I found a combination of base colors that I'm happy with. So I'm gonna let this dry for a little bit and then hit it with a flat coat. Then I can start nailing things down to it. Got the switch plate on the front. And when dealing with switch plates, there's two things you can do. You can either try to disguise them or you can call them out. In this case, I am calling it out because I want to do the same treatment on that I used on the helmet and the shoulder pads with that rusted or oxidized looking bronze. So I made very obvious screw heads and a switch to hang out there so that I can do that effect to it. And then once this is flat coated, I'll go back in with the glossy, slimy, incubus black, incubus darkness on the tendrils, and really work those in, and then I can start nailing things down, like putting the flashlight in and putting Kane's body on there, and then we'll be down into the short rows. Working on the head as well, I have not been able to secure a better one than this, so I think I'm going to go ahead and look into making that one do. By the time he's bent over the egg, I don't know how much of him is actually going to be seen, but better this than nothing. Okay, well, as you can tell, I've got the beautiful bit of wiring down underneath here, and that's basically hooks everything up to the switch, hooks the light up to the switch, hooks this extension wire up to the switch that will go up into the body. And the last thing I want to do for this evening is to epoxy this base down so that it's sitting up overnight and I can sand it flush tomorrow. So let's mix up some 5-minute epoxy and get this laid down. And we got enough clamps on there, I think, to hold it down. And we're going to let the epoxy set up on there for an hour or so before I take these clamps off. Even though it's 5-minute epoxy, you don't get graded badly if you leave the clamps on for more than 5 minutes. So, and we'll play with a little bit of switch here so you can see, yes, that does turn the flashlight on, which means power is coming up to these wires, and that's what's going to go into Kane. So, flip that back off. Well, welcome back. It is Thursday, the gateway to the weekend, and we're going to continue working on the Kane base today and see how much more of it we can get done. I have yesterday I epoxied the bottom plate on, and this morning I just took some nippers here and trimmed off as much as I could trim off with that, and now I'm going to just take it outside and use the Dremel to ease that edge down and sand it down to where it matches the rest of the base. So I'm not going to bore you with that. Next time you see it, it shall be done. And the next thing to do after that will be to, I need to do a little bit of painting on the base to make those colors work. And then I could start thinking about wiring up the helmet. There are some details that need to be painted on the helmet, and I haven't decided whether or not to paint those now or to put the helmet on the shoulders and then paint it. So let me figure that out. But first things first, I'm going to go sand this base to clean it up. Okay, you can see the bottom part has been all trimmed down and matches, and I repainted the incubi darkness and black mixture on the tendrils to the egg. And I need to also touch this color now too. But the big project for today is going to be the helmet. there are things that I can do, I think I've said this before, things I can do with the helmet in place and things that are better for you to be done before I put it in place. And one of the things I need to do is attach these inside windows, or to these windows, to the back of the helmet, and they have to be attached from the inside, which is something that's infinitely easier to do now than it is to do once it's in place. And also I need to touch up the dashboard one last time, take care of some light leaks one last time before I set it in place. Okay, we have a helmet issue that I wish to bring to your attention. Both the instructions and, let's see, we zoom in on those, the instructions and the natural fit of the part want you to attach the back glass pieces from the outside. The parts seem to fit better when you stick them on from the outside, and the instructions say put them on from the outside. But all of the reference material that I can find tells me that it wants to be attached from the inside. Now, what I'm using for reference is this old book, and the fact that it tells you this is from the new 20th Century Fox film Alien should tell you something, because the movie came out in 79. So, yes, this is a very old book. This is back when I still used to sign my books. This, let me see if I can find a advertised printing date. Anyway, it's old. And it's got some very good reference pictures, not a lot of them in color, but a particularly good one of the helmet is right here. And you can clearly see, as soon as I do this with one hand, you can clearly see that the framework, the glass bubble, is inside the framework. If it were outside, it would be coming all the way out to here. So it's meant to sit inside that inside frame, but the problem with it is the part will have to have some significant sanding to it. See if I can find another one. Significant sanding to it to make it fit. Here you go. Here's another one. Look at Dallas's helmet right here. Let me zoom in on it. Come on, there you go. Okay, and you can clearly see the inset of the glass inside that framework. And even on Lambert's, you could see much better that that's supposed to be inside, or else the glare would be much larger. So I'm going to see if these parts can be sanded down or adapted somehow to make those fit better. Very well. As you know by now, if I'm given the choice between two alternatives, I will invariably take the third. So I did not attach it from the inside. I attached it from the outside, but I sanded it down to make it smaller so that it fit further inside the frame. And now I've got some clear canopy glue around the outside to glue it in. I'm not all that concerned about keeping him clean, because this helmet is famous for being probably the dirtiest glass I've ever seen in a movie. I remember seeing it at the time thinking, how can they even see out of those things? They were so fogged up and they were so scratched up and scuffed up. Now, that's not going to be my goal. Usually I found the perfect way to scratch up something is to pretend to try to keep it clean and let the natural scratches that happen, because I'm not that great. So I'm going to try to keep these clean, and whatever scratches or scuffs happen, that's going to happen. And I may yet even take a light coat of dust spray after it's all done and spray around the perimeter of the windows or the visor, just like I did on the hopper kit, if you remember that, to make the windows look like they were fogged up. I may do that on these after they have had a chance to dry. After that, when that clear canopy glue dries, a lot of that will go away. So we'll have to judge how much is left and how much more needs painted. And here you can see it. I've got the glass pieces inset, and I am letting the canopy glue dry, so I need to set that aside for a while. And probably work on the base a little bit more. This is canopy glue, and it does not dry as quickly as other glues, so it needs some tender loving care. And to be left alone, most importantly. Now, the big dome in the front will not have that same problem, since it is clearly applied from the outside. So that'll be easy. That's probably the last piece that will ever go on, because the head, this goes down on the shoulders, then the head goes in, and then the front piece goes on front of the head. So until I hear anything different, I will be using the stock head the kit came with. And while the helmet is out drying in the noonday sun, I decided to just make the best of it and go with the stock head. And so I've been playing around with aging up the little beanie cap and painting in the face as best I can. Now this is going to be more or less buried, because it's going to be down at this weird angle, plus have a helmet in front of it that will be weathered and smoked up. So the likeness is maybe not as important as I was stressing it to be. So I've got the last bit of base painted here. I want to, I've added some more veins inside by using the white tulip to give it some dimension, and then I'll wash over top of those. But I'm trying to make this as appropriately goopy as possible. And this has got the what's going wrong here? That light should be light. Not good. That was a bit of a scare. I don't know what it was, but I think, these wires were sitting on top of each other, which were shorting them out. These are the bare wires that go up to the rest of the body, and if they touch each other, they short out everything. So let's not do that again. Okay, it's time for another bit of momentousness. Let me push some stuff around here and get it out of the way. It's time to put the helmet on the body. Now, there is some painting left to be done to the helmet, but that can be better served using the whole body as leverage to hold on to while I am doing. So here is our helmet, and here is our body. Now, the delicate thing about all of this is snaking the wires down through this hole and out the backpack. And let's just go ahead and get to that. Let me see, I need to have a little bit of, remove this foam over here, because this body is clattering around on this glass top, and the noise bugs me, plus I don't want it to crack or do anything other destructively. So having this little piece of foam down, just regular craft foam, you can get it at Michael's or AC Moore or whatever, but it gives me a nice cushion for that. So all I'm going to do is take these groups of wires one by one, and I already see a problem. I see something that needs to be resoldered. So let me take care of that first. I'll be right back. Okay, one quick fix of a wire later, and we are back in business. I've got the helmet down, although I have to tell you, look inside there. That is not a seal I would check my life on. You can see the big old gap behind the back of the helmet, between the helmet and the shoulders. I wouldn't want to depend my life on that seal. It looks pretty good around the outside, but on the inside, it's nastiness. So I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a little bit of epoxy sculpt, and I'm just going to pack it down in there and fill that in, which means I won't be able to put the head in today, which is fine because I've got tomorrow to do that. But it'll set the helmet and also immobilize those wires, and then I can take care of this nastiness and coil this up and maybe attach it to that, and then we'll have all of our wiring set. One thing you can really tell about when the summer comes and the humidity rises and the heat goes up, if it makes the epoxy sculpt a lot easier to work with. I'm just going to mix this up and roll out some wee little worms. Nothing too exciting with all of that.
Since the last time you saw this, I don't think you saw that I had put the googly eye cover over the gauge there.
And there you go. I've more or less sculpted an airtight seal onto the back of this helmet. And the nice thing about sculpting it is I can make it look like a continuation of this bottom fold of material. Now, what you're seeing is the painted versus the unpainted, but once this is dry, I will sand it a mite and paint it up, and you'll never know the difference. So I'm going to let that sit, and I'm going to, while this is healing up, I am going to start working on condensing all these wires. Okay, here we go, and what this is telling me that even with this awkward pose and all of that going on, that you are still going to see a goodly portion of those, the dashboard lights and his face. Let me go ahead and flip this on. There you go. There's the flashlight. I have not put the light inside the egg yet, but there are all of the dashboard lights shining up on his face the way I like, but I do see some more light leaks that need to be tended to. And two lights back here, the lights is divided into four there, and the lights on the backpack. So all is left to do is to coil up this wiring and jam it back into his chest. Yes, his chest is burst with all those wires. Looks more like Ash than he does Kane at this point. But I want to go ahead and neaten up those wires and get the backpack glued down. There is without the lights. Try it with a different white balance, because every time I turn that overhead fluorescent off, it throws the white balance out of whack. But yeah, you can really see the lighting on the dashboard where it needs to be divided out, and get the tulip back out and really block off the lights that I don't want to have lit there. Even with the foggy face shield, it's still going to be quite noticeable. So, yay. Well, ladies and germs, I got to tell you, that's in. And lights are all working. Sometimes you fret and plan and plan and fret something, and sometimes you just get caught up in the motion and you got to follow it through. As I was tucking those wires in, it became obvious that I was not going to be able to let the backpack be dangling, so I whipped up a little bit of, actually what I needed to use was epoxy putty, because I needed a putty that was a fast setup, much faster than epoxy sculpt, because I wanted to put some putty on the back of the back of the backpack and kind of push it onto the back of the figure. And the epoxy putty sets up a lot quicker, so it was able to take and bite down where it needs to go. And that is that's curing, and that's where we're going to leave it for tonight. We have one good day of super detailing tomorrow, and we should be done. Got a lot of little picky things to paint, and I've got to let this epoxy sculpt on the collar and this epoxy putty cure and come back tomorrow and paint and finish up. But everything is as it should be. You can really see in that dashboard where I need to tweak and refine that, and put the head in and put the faceplate on, and we'll be ready to button this thing up. I got to do a little bit more work on the egg, and I can do that tonight because it's a complete separate entity and I don't need to be dependent on anything else to be working on that. Let's save the battery and let this cure. Yay! Very happy. Well, good morning and welcome back to Friday and what will probably be the final day of work on the Kane, Officer Kane, Executive Officer Kane model kit from Polar Lights, available at finer hobby shops and online. Get yours today, kids. I have let everything set up overnight, checking the lights, everything, come on, everything still works. Always happy when that happens. I've had time for the epoxy putties and all of that to cure overnight, and so today It is nothing but the really small, picky detail work and doing any scratch building that needs to be added. One thing that's most notable, that the first thing I wanted to scratch build was, there's a secondary cable. At least there was on the costume as it was sold at auction, and that's what I have the really good reference of. So I'm going to add that second cable, and what it looked like was this. It's a fat cable with a thinner cable wrapped around it rather loosely. And it went from the back of the, it was a second cable that came out of the helmet, and it went around the side, and I think it was meant to go into this chest piece, or this waist piece right here. So I am going to, now that I've made this up out of just two different widths of wire, or gauges of wire, I'm just going to mysteriously super glue it to a spot here, and then take it under there and glue it to another spot there. But first, I want to, since I'll be covering this, I want to paint this epoxy sculpt that's been setting up overnight, and then age it and get it all taken care of, because once that cable was in, I wouldn't be able to get behind it. So I want to do all the things that I'm going to lose access to. So let me do that first. Okay, I'm not quite sure how this happened, because I thought I was pressing them in pretty darn good when I glued them down, but apparently there is some gap underneath that left foot between that and the ground. So I'm going to pack some epoxy sculpt in there and sculpt in some dirt and make it look like his foot is actually seated on the ground. I'll have to touch that up later, but I'll go ahead and get the putty in. And the detailing work continues on Kane on a Friday morning, and this went in a little bit easier than I have any right to expect it to. I'm kind of delighted and frightened at the same time. I got the painting redone behind here on this collar, which was the epoxy sculpt, and then I just whipped this thing into place, and shockingly, it went in without a fight. Now, I'm probably going to distress this because the black is a little stark for everything else. I might put a little bit of a gray dry brush over top of that. But, yeah, that went in pretty darn well. And I'm playing with the tendrils here and trying to make them slimy and appropriately icky. And I've drug out yet another vintage reference, and that is this. This is a photo novel. Yes, kids, back in the days before you had even VHS readily available, you didn't have home video to rely on. You didn't have cable that will run a movie to death 100 times a week. You had to rely on things like photo novels to remember a movie that you just saw. Or sometimes even record albums. Oh my goodness, I remember listening to the story of Star Wars and the story of Raiders of the Lost Ark on record. Yes, I am ancient. But this is a movie novel with over 1,000 full-color photos of the movie. Yes, an R-rated movie where a child could pick up and watch and buy a book in a store of an R-rated movie. Of course, you couldn't hear the dialogue, but you could see the images. What I am using this for is this one particular very good picture of the, well, actually, one more page. Yes, there it is. The excellent picture of the inside of the egg. And also, very excellent references of Kane's head. And having looked at Kane's head in these references, I can tell you that this Snoopy ball cap is too dark. I need to lighten that up considerably. It should almost be a pale, pale green. I still like the yellow around the face, and I still like the face such as it is, even though it doesn't look much like John Hurt, but that has to be brightened up considerably. So I'll work on that, and I'll work on making this look more something like something that was in the movie. Yay. Okay, we're down to the final stages. Almost done. I spent the day picking at tiny details and glossing over some others and fixing that dashboard so that it's a little bit more defined, and fogging up the helmet screens and working on the head. And all I've got to do now is pop the head in place and put the front windscreen in place, and I will be done. I think it turned out pretty sharp. May want to take some nice moody atmospheric pictures with it, but to the point where I am worried about overworking the egg in particular, so I am going to let that set for a while, walk away and come back to it. Maybe one more round of dry brushing over it and it'll be done, but the inside I'm very happy with. Nice and slimy and glossy. Well, we're coming down to the wire on Friday evening as far as how much time I want to spend on a Friday evening, and we're down to the last bit, and the last bit is putting this faceplate on, and I was hoping it was going to go a lot easier than it is because it does not want to fit. So I am doing the same thing I did with these pieces, and I am sanding it down ever so slightly so that I can fit it into the frame that it belongs. I have barely finished Kane this week. This dome is in and it is drying, and that's going to finish up the Kane, Officer Kane figure or model kit from the kind people at Round 2. Come on, let's get a light in here. There we go. Get the light on. Get the egg in. Come on, there you go. Egg is in and the lights are all on. And the dome is in. I'm gonna let that dome dry and then put some tulip around it to hold it in. And then fog it up just a little bit more. But yeah. The world's stupidest game of Jack in the Box. This makes a nice little table model. I was quite surprised. I was thinking of it in two different terms, you know. It's nice, but I was kind of going back and forth about the merits of it being an actual nice model until I put Kane on the base, and that's what made the difference. As a base, you know, the egg and the lantern, that was one thing, and the figure wasn't all that much by itself. But putting it together with the egg on the base really makes this a nice presentation piece. Commend the people at Round 2 for this, because it's styrene and resin, which don't always play well together. That's why this dome wasn't fitting quite well, because it's injected styrene and the dome or the helmet is resin, and therefore, you know, it could shrink up and not necessarily stay the same shape. So I think that's why the two halves weren't meshing the way they should. But a little bit of research, some fun work doing that, figuring out all of those yellows. Had to watch the movie again. You know, it's one of those things, as soon as you start, you can't stop. You got to watch the whole thing again. So that was fun. Got to dig out some 30-year-old reference. That was fun, too. 79. Almost, 79, 09, or 89, 99, 09, 19. Almost 40 years old reference. Looks pretty sharp. Pretty spiffy. And I'll be taking this to Wonderfest. So if any of you want to meet me there, this will be in competition. So I'll see you then. So until next week, when we'll start something brand new. I haven't quite noodled out yet what that's going to be, but luckily for me, I have the whole weekend to figure that out. Until next week, be careful. Don't step into any alien egg farms unaware. Watch where you're putting your face. Don't stick it down into something you don't know, or else something horrible could jump up at you. So until then, have a good week.
Be good to each other, and we'll see you, well, both of us will see you here next time. Free hugs.